We went and let a few people to get in, but since it is 4 o'clock, we are going to get started. She is the reason that any of us are here in the first place. She's changed a lot of lives, and today we're going to have a conversation with her and some stories and experiences from the life of the one, the only, Lauren Faust.
So a lot of the grander world of my little
not just based on fairy tales, but like sort of classic fantasy stuff. I've often called like Canterlot, I always used to call Gondor for girls. like built into the side of a mountain, you know. It's like, so bringing those like bigger, grander ideas again from these books and these stories that had themes that I loved. So very much of it came from that as well.
So you drew from a vast amount of different things then. Were there any other media that influenced you, or did you pull mainly from literature and things like that?
In a general sense, I feel like that was kind of it. Since in terms of when we were making the show, you know, a lot of sensibilities came from, you know, my love of animation, of course, and you know, studying animation, going to school for animation, having worked in animation for a while. So even things about like tone and cartooniness, you know, even like I think even little bits and snippets of like Bugs Bunny and Chuck Jones got in there. Like, you know, an anvil falls on Twilight Sparkle's head. I mean, that's Looney Tunes. You know, so even that got in there too.
That's kind of amazing. Could you tell us about meeting the production team and the VAs when you first met them for the first time, and what your impressions are and how it went?
You have to forgive me because it really was a very long time ago for me at this point. This is several years ago. I was kind of isolated from a lot of the creative team once we got to production because everything was being done in Canada, and I was down here in the States by myself. I had my writing team, but I only saw my writers, you know, one day a week and any individual white writers. Like, I'd only see everybody maybe once a month or something to work with the writing. So when we went to cast the show, Studio B, which is now DHX, auditioned a bunch of Canadian actresses that I never met. You know, having worked in LA, I had a lot of actresses that I like to work with, but that wasn't an option. We had to work with Canadian artists exclusively. So they sent me auditions. So these were names I didn't know. I'd look them up, faces I wasn't familiar with. I was just listening to the voices. So, and I was listening to them to see whether or not they, A, were funny, B, great, good actors, and C, embodied the feeling of the character, of what we wanted from the character. So my first impressions were almost like entirely professional in that sense, because all I was hearing were their voices.
Wow, I genuinely did not know that.
Yeah.
It was a learning experience. Were there any surprises when it came to pairing VAs with the respective characters as things went along?
Well, again, just because it's just a process of, and this is how it works everywhere. They do auditions from anywhere between maybe four or five people to, you know, sometimes over a dozen. So, I mean, you listen to the voices and you make your pick and there it goes. So I don't know if anything's particularly surprising. because you cast your cast and make your picks.
It certainly went a long way to making the show as popular as it is, a lot of the voice acting and your character designs really carried it into this entire fandom. It would not have worked as well without those concepts in the beginning, so I just want to say thank you for that.
Oh, you're welcome, thank you.
That never really got to appear in the show that you would have liked to have seen someday?
I don't know. came up with all the basic concepts. You know, again, from a point of practicality and just the profession of animation, you know, it costs money to have 10 bazillion locations. Mm-hmm. So you pick the ones that you're going to use over and over again. So, you know, we had Ponyville, Canterlot, oh my gosh, what's the name of where the Pegasus live?
Rockville!
Thank you!
same locations, expecting to go through them constantly throughout the series. So I'm not sure I can say that there were any locations that I had come up with. That, you know, and when you're making these shows and you're working with your writers, you know that it's going to evolve as you're going. So you know that new locations and new ideas and new characters are going to come up as you're creating the show. So I was just sitting back to wait to see what would happen. So
were there any plot lines or any character? Because you said it's a very character-driven show, and you conceptualized it as this very character-driven piece. Are there any directions you would have liked to take characters in?
Yeah, there were a handful of characters that I thought that I had kind of planned arcs for. I had a little bit of a different idea for where the Cutie Mark Crusaders were going to go than I think eventually how they turned out. So for them, the big thing I wanted to do in particular was with Sweet Belle and Scootaloo. So the Cutie Mark Crusaders want their cutie marks. And they're trying all these different things they want to do to find what their life's purpose is so their cutie marks would appear. And Sweetie Belle initially just wanted to be like her sister, you know? So she wanted to be an artist, she wanted to sew, she wanted to be beautiful, and she was pursuing this particular dream. Same with Scootaloo. Scootaloo was pursuing this dream to fly, like her idol, Rainbow Dash. The story I wanted to tell with those two was that, you know, we don't always, it's gonna sound sad at first, we don't always get our dreams, you know? Sometimes you work really hard pursuing a very specific goal, something that in your brain you think you're meant to do or that you really want to do, but sometimes we find out that our life has a different purpose than what we're shooting for. And what both Sweetie Belle and Scootaloo, I wanted them to learn was just that. Sweetie Belle didn't even realize she had this beautiful singing voice. And once she gave up trying to be someone she wasn't and embraced what was really talented about her, and same with Scootaloo, that maybe she'd never be able to fly, but she's amazing on her scooter, that their cutie marks would appear once they really accepted who they were. And that was the arc that I was going with for those characters. I understand it ended a little bit differently for them in the show, but that's an example of some characters that I had specific arcs in mind.
It certainly sounds like a lesson the little girls should learn.
Could use a lesson like that. I think that's true of everybody. I think there's all like when we're kids, we have dreams for ourselves, those things that we want to do. Something as big as I want to be a rock star, something as mundane as, you know, maybe I want to get married, you know. Sometimes we don't get our dreams, but that doesn't mean that life, there's something more important that you're meant for.
Were there any lessons in particular? Because it's quite an educational show, sort of life lessons and emotional intelligence. Is there anything in particular you wanted your audience, at the point when you started, you wanted them to get out of the show from a learning perspective?
Well, maybe nothing so specific. I think those are the kinds of stories I want to tell. You know, some storytellers just want to make you laugh. Some of them just want to keep you on the edge of your seat. There's different ways to get an audience riveted and interested in a story. And for me, that is about connecting to a character and relating to their journey. So in all the stories I like to tell, they are all about a character learning something about themselves. So it's partly for the audience, you know, like the story about the Cutie Mark Crusaders, that is a life lesson for somebody to learn. And, you know, part of me is like, yeah, sure, this could really help somebody someday. But the other part of me is like, this is entertaining. You know, this is fun to watch a character to get really invested in the character and their flaws, and seeing them going like, oh, you're so close, I just want to see you get it right. And when you're really invested in the character and you see them change and you see them learn, that's satisfying and that's entertaining. And that's storytelling to me.
You can definitely see that it's carried through into a lot of your work, that angle of character-driven storytelling. And it is really admirable that across your entire repertoire, you have carried through on that dedication to characters. It is very, very admirable.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, like I said, that's just how I like to tell stories.
Certainly works. Have you had any ideas that have found homes in other projects that you've worked on postponing?
A little bit, maybe not in any sort of specific sort of way. You know, because every show is different, every character is different, every team that you work with is different, and it's important to use the strengths of your team and work with your team and their ideas. But in terms of like themes and concepts, without being able to come up with anything specific, I would say yes. You know, that I'm like, oh, I didn't quite get to go to this place with this character that I wanted to, but here I have this new character that's in a similar situation. I can take them to a similar place, even if it's not exactly the same thing. It's like, oh, I can finally tell that story about that feeling, or I can finally tell that story about that lesson, even though it isn't exactly the same as it would have been in the other show. It could be similar in this one.
So that you do that, get that creative satisfaction, you just postponed a little bit.
Yeah, and then I think that's a big thing about being creative in general. Recently, in a lot of talks that I've had, the question of rejection has come up a number of times, and how to deal with rejection. And I remind people that, you know, just because somebody said no to something now doesn't mean that it's done forever. You know, you might be able to revisit that idea 10 years from now, 15 years from now, the timing could be different. You just haven't found the person who likes that idea yet, or the right venue to use that idea in. So, yeah, you just put it in your pocket and take it out later.
Do you have like a book of unused ideas? You're like, right, I can fit through this.
It's all in here.
Oh my.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that I don't write it. I don't know. It just sticks in there. I tend to remember it.
The good ideas stay just right there.
Yeah.
What are some of the more memorable moments of working on Pony and working with your team?
What do you think? There's so many, and they're all sort of like, some of them are big, some of them are small. Like one thing that I remember was being in the story meeting for Sonic Rainboom with Robin, Teddy, and Meech Larson. And I just remember we were working through that story and going like, oh, this one's gonna be good. Like it was just kind of coming together really well, and then everything was falling into place. And you know, sometimes you're working on stories and you have to like really struggle to make it work, and that one just came together really nicely. So then when that episode, that's my favorite episode in season one, and you know, so when it all came together in the end, that was very satisfying, but it was very satisfying to kind of know that I could tell. That's a strong memory. Here's kind of a little, like a small one, but kind of a funny one. Well, first I should start with like getting to direct John Delancey was a very memorable moment. As a big, very big Star Trek fan, we told the Hasbro executives when they were asking us about Discord, and we said, like, it's like Q from Star Trek. And they went, can we get John Delancey? I'm like, you tell me. Can we? I don't know. I want to. So getting to meet him and direct him for the first time, I was so nervous. I was really, really nervous. And he's going to kill me. He kept saying Shutterfly instead of Fluttershy. And I was so embarrassed having to ask him to correct himself. But very endearing. But I was just so nervous through the whole thing. And then another little small little snippet was, you know, John coming from live action and I kept asking him to deliver the lines a little faster. Couldn't get him to be quite as fast as I needed him to be, because in cartoons people talk at a pretty fast clip. So you can speed up characters' voices quite a bit. Most of the shows I work on, the actors deliver their lines. You want it to sound natural, so you don't want them to speed through the lines. You ask them to speed them up like 5 to 10%. Which is usually forgivable on animation. But with John, the episode was a little too long. I said, can we speed him up 15%? And I remember her like being really excited that we sped him all the way up to 15% and it still sounded okay. I'm like, yes. It was a very small, little, silly sort of thing. But for somehow that really sticks in my memory.
Shows such a lot of pride in your work that that's something you go, yes.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, exactly. So of all those small, of all the little things, that was one that stood out. I could probably prattle on forever. Just like little tiny details like that. I'm trying to think of like any of the ones that were just like big and significant. But most of those revolve around like when I started seeing the reactions online that were like bigger than I ever expected. Those were some pretty memorable moments, just finding threads and threads and threads of people talking about it, going like, what is happening?
What was that like when you started? When did you realize it had gone beyond its initial audience into this?
I started, what was it? It's gonna sound weird, but when I started seeing people talking about it in a positive way on 4chan. the positive part of that being the important part, like that's when I think I realized that like this is not what I was expecting.
Say weird is relative when you're at a Brony convention. What was the reaction of the team when, like, who realized first that it was getting so big and was getting this strangely adult audience?
Well, like I mentioned before, I was a little bit isolated from most of the team. I was working from my home office from day to day while everybody was up in Vancouver. So the only story that I ever got related to me about from anybody realizing that this was blowing up was from Mitch, who I sent him and the writers. I had found a video of a Russian Brony get together where a bunch of adult Russian dudes got together and were singing Winter Wrap Up. I don't remember how I stumbled across that online. And I sent that to my writers, and Mitch told me that that was like when it hit him. then he was like, oh, this is going to be something we were not expecting, like, at all. Like, that, he said that's when it hit him. Which I think is fun, because, like, that would hit anybody.
Yeah, that's definitely dropping you in the deep end.
Yeah.
Were there any practical jokers in the group that you work with?
Again, I don't want to be boring, but I spent most of my time alone. Just in my home office 4 days a week, just like doing notes and drawing like alone and emailing things to everybody. So I practical joked myself.
We're going to take just a couple of questions. There was an online poll that BronyCon ran. I got some questions. Do you want to answer those?
Sure.
What's your favorite episode that you worked on and or watched? And that's from Rolling Wonder.
From what?
Rolling Wonder is the person who asked this. What is your favorite episode that you worked on or that you watched?
I think I mentioned it before. I really enjoyed Sonic Rainbow from the beginning to the end. From its inception and from its completion. That is the best episode of season one to me.
What was it about that one that really captured you? Oh, this is amazing.
That one for me, felt like this is what I would want the show to be. That's when everything kind of came together. I hate to be boring again, but it just keeps coming back to Sonic Rainbow for me.
Why you state your vision plan for the main six? Did you ever have a vision or specific goal plan for Spike?
I had a few little ideas here and there that I wasn't sure. Again, you know, while you're working with your writers and working with your team and seeing how things evolve and change, you know, maybe this character will go in this direction, maybe that character will go in this direction, but I do think that I figured that by the end of it all, he would at the very least grow to his full size and just be a gigantic, epic, awesome dragon breathing fire all over the place and ponies riding on his back and being super cool.
You heard it here, guys.
But then always like his sweet self on the inside and like the fun irony of somebody being just majestic and huge and amazing and also just like still really nice and sweet.
Still looking up to Twilight even if he's looking down at her.
Exactly.
Out of all the shows you've worked on, which character would you say was the most fun to design?
It's funny because like the ponies are basically all the same except different hair. slightly different eye shapes. So the only one that really kind of I'd say would stand out. Let's see. It wasn't that there were characters that were more fun to design than other ones, but ones that might have been a little more challenging. Rarity stands out to me because there's an interesting design aspect to her hair that's based off of the character Margaret from Dennis the Menace, where her hair looks like it's a flat piece of paper that's just curled in a, and let's see, I think there were like maybe five different versions of Granny Smith before we settled on, it was really hard to figure out how to draw a really old pony and still make her appealing. Spike, I'm actually particularly proud of. Like every time I look at him, I'm like, I did a good job on him. I was trying to find a really, like a middle ground between a dragon and a toddler. So that's why he kind of has a bit of a diaper butt. So he's got the little arched back, and his belly sticks out, his butt's kind of big, and his little legs are a little bit hyperextended because I wanted him to look like a little two-year-old toddling around to try to make him cute. So I'm actually pretty proud of the Spike character design.
I ain't discarded it like that, now I'm left alone.
It's got a diaper butt.
Start with which one came to you like first, earliest in the process, you went, that's it, that's the one I'm going with?
Well, when I was first doing the initial character designs, I was working with the G1s, the versions of them that were still G1s in my head, and I was just trying to come up with the, you know, what is the base pony body, because I knew that's where it was going to go. It's like all ponies were going to be the same, they're just going to have different hair. But of course, the character that I was drawing to try to figure out what a basic pony would look like was Firefly, which became Rainbow Dash, so that's who I'd say.
You work post-pony. Is there anything in particular that you've enjoyed designing, just character-wise, after MLP? Any shows you've worked on afterwards?
You know, not to sound like a shameless plugger, but I'm really proud of my character designs on Superhero Girls. I spent a lot of time, it was super important to me that they, you know, we have a show about teenage girls, and I wanted to show how different teenage girls could be and could look. So I had six characters and six different bodies. Take one look at your character, or that anybody who isn't involved can take one look at your character and take a pretty good guess of who they are and what their personality is like. And I spent a lot of time on the Superhero Girls designs all six of those main girls. The six boys, the six villains, the boys and the villains, a lot of people on my team, I worked with them with, but the six main girls I designed myself, and I'm very pleased with them. Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about superhero girls, because it's clearly really important to you. What went into your thought process for each of those designs, as in what were you trying to achieve with each one? Was there something in particular that you wanted to get across?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that's why they were so fun and why they took me so long, was because I had to embody who they are as heroes and what their powers are, along with their personalities. So in terms of like thinking about their body types and like, you know, Supergirl is about strength, you know, and in the comics, Supergirl, you know, Superman looks like he's been taking steroids for 500 years. But Supergirl looks like, you know, this wavy little petite little thing. And I'm like, well, how does this Krypton stuff work? I mean, do you come to Earth and get roided out? Or can you be as skinny as anything and still be able to throw cars around? So I wanted to bring that musculature to Supergirl. So I had to like, but she's also in our group, kind of the rebellious character, so I wanted to embody this idea of super strength and how can a girl look awesome with big muscles, but then also look like this rebellious, kind of irreverent sort of, you know, character with a slightly bad temper, and trying to incorporate that to design as well. So I did that with all of them. You know, Wonder Woman was fun for me because she's an Amazon, but she's a teenage Amazon, and you know, I come from family of very tall people, and I know that you know, as big as anybody might be when they're tall as an adult, they probably had a period in their life as a teenager where they were gangly beanpole. So a teenage Amazon might be really, really tall, but she might also be like a little bit gangly, a little bit awkward, but still trying to like preserve her strength. A Batgirl I saw, she doesn't have superpowers, but she, you know, she's very acrobatic, very lithe, so I tried to design her like a little spring. So I sort of like ran the gamut like across all of my characters of like trying to like, what is their superpower, who are they as people, and how can I get that across visually in one character design.
Did you have any voice actors in mind, particularly while you were designing, that thinking, I wish I could have X, Y, and Z playing these characters?
Well, I had already done some shorts. Are you still talking about superhero girls?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I had already done some shorts with Supergirl, Batgirl, and it was Wonder Girl, not Wonder Woman, so I wanted to bring those actresses back. Gray Delisle is Wonder Woman. She said yes. Nicole Sullivan is Supergirl, and she was on board. And of course, Tara Strong is Batgirl, who's also Twilight Sparkle. Tara's also Harley Quinn. She's also the Cheetah. So, and then the other three actresses were with the same process as Pony, all auditions. So those are the three actresses I had never worked with before, and I plan on working with again. They're fabulous.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
We're going to go into live Q&A, if that's okay with you?
Yeah, certainly.
Right, so security are going to make sure that those with accessibility issues are coming to the front first. Yep, they've done their notes for this. If they can organize, you can please get into a line here by the microphone. We have that spot off, please, because we've got a blind in the audience. Thank you. Where's blind me instead, that's fine. So it is those with accessibility issues at the front, please. If we have a couple of steps behind the people at the front, just to make sure there's no traffic issues.
Oh, good. Need that. Well done.
Thank you.
Could you get a little bit closer to the microphone, Hannah, because we can't quite hear you. Thank you, sweet.
That's right. So we're supposedly in another golden age of animation, and we're seeing a lot more women entering the animation industry and creating new animated series. Can you share your thoughts on that?
It's actually like a really wonderful time for women in animation right now. I think a lot of doors have opened in the last few years. I think they've opened because the studios and the media companies are finally acknowledging that girls like things like comic books and cartoons. And on top of that, they're giving it a try and it's working. So it's a really exciting thing to see things like, movies like Captain Marvel come out and be successful. I don't think they would have 15 years ago. Because I think there's also a shift in giving women a chance. There's a shift in giving girl characters and girl shows a chance, but there's also a shift in minds of boys and men that they don't have to be embarrassed liking things about girls or looking up to characters who are girls. And it's really amazing for me to see that finally setting in. So it's a wonderful time for women in animation right now.
Well, thank you for all you've done, and keep up the great work with everything.
Thank you.
Can we move that spotlight again, please? Thank you, I think it should be back. Thank you!
Thank you!
Hi, my name is Tristan. You signed my Powerpuff Girls autograph thing earlier. Is it secret, everyone? I mean, she made our childhood, our teenagehood, and now our adulthood with four great, fantastic shows. You know, let's give a round of applause for that. Okay, I have three questions I would like to ask you. The first one, when I was reading an article about your tweets back in 2013, when people were asking you Q&A questions, and you had planned more stories for like Runa and Sakura, and then I saw something on when you were being interviewed at a panel at GalCon 2016. You said that you had your own idea of how Runa, of why Runa turned into Nightmare Moon, and like even how, but you wanted to keep it a secret. And after doing a lot of thinking about it, I was thinking that like I could try a crack at it.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Did you want to try a crack at it?
I did, yes. You do. You do keep your idea of how Luna became Nightmare Moon like in your own mind, like a secret. Like,
I think he's asking like what was your original theory for how Luna became Nightmare Moon?
And you said at GalCon that it was a secret.
I don't remember.
I don't. I'm trying to remember like what I thought. I mean, why Luna became Nightmare Moon? Earlier I said it's all in here and I remember it all, and I guess not. Maybe I wrote it down in some notes. I think you mentioned Sakura earlier, and I had a brief idea that Sakura might have actually been a zebra from our world, and that maybe the Everfree Forest was a little bit of a portal between Equestria and Earth. and that Zecora may have crossed through that portal from the savannah into the Everfruit Forest and gained speech and her cutie mark. And that was a little bit of a snippet of an idea of something I thought I might, a direction I might take Zecora in. So it's like, I'm sorry, I can't seem to like jog my memory now, but there's some Zecora
actually, that brings me into my second question. Do you plan on telling what? Now, it seems that Hasbro is making 1 hour shorts of MLP now that the show's ending to kind of expand the world a little bit. Are you planning on turning your headcanon into Celestia Mina's backstory into one of those like 1 hour shorts? Like, are you gonna give Hasbro permission to be like, yeah, sure, you can take my idea for what I originally had in mind for Celestia Mina's backstory and use it in that medium?
I think he's asking, would you like the backstory you originally came up for with these characters to be turned into 1 hour specials?
You know what? I actually thought maybe they could be once. there was a time that I thought that maybe I actually had a big weird thing I worked out about the Everfree Forest and the Temple of the Sisters and all that sort of stuff. And I thought it might be one day a fun spin-off series to tell the ancient stories of the sisters and the Alicorns and what that place was, what the ruins were before the Everfree Forest took over that part of Equestria. But I never thought out much more than that, but I thought like, oh, if there was ever gonna be a spin-off, that might be a fun thing to explore is more ancient Equestria and what it was like before, you know, this time. Because, you know, like Celestia's supposed to be 1,000 years old. What was her life like when she was only 200 years old?
Thank you very much for your questions.
Thank you.
We're gonna try and limit it to one question per person, because we've got a long queue. So one question per person from now on, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm Tobin. I wanted to know if Craig helped with any of the background characters' designs or ideas.
Craig actually helped me a little bit with Discord. You know what, it's kind of funny. I was really tired that day, and then I had to turn the design around. I was struggling a little bit with his head. So I asked Craig what his opinion, what he thought, and he did a few little sketches for me. So there's a little bit of Craig in Discord, and Craig actually helped me design the uniforms for the Wonderbolts. Thank you. That's definitely interesting information. He and I like to say that when you hire one of us, you get the other one as a creative consultant for free.
How long that took?
I don't have the rights to anything. DC and Warner Brothers came and asked me, they said, we own these characters, can you tell some stories about them? I own nothing.
How long did it take you to get that show into production?
Superhero Girls was in development for about a year, and then we started to staff up after that. It was 4 months before we started actually like moving into production, so like a little less than a year and a half, which is actually kind of fast.
So we definitely need to get the word out there on Superhero Girls, guys. We need to watch this. It needs to come back for a second season. Yes, round of applause for Superhero Girls, please.
Thank you.
The incorporation of what, sorry? It's a little hard to
understand. Get a little closer to the mic, please.
I repeat the question. In Generation 1, the original series, there were humans in the show, human beings.
Humans, right.
Have you ever considered using humans in G4?
I had briefly, when I was developing My Little Pony, I had anticipated that Hasbro might ask me to bring Megan into the story. So I had a little bit of an idea of, again, I don't know what's up with me and portals between worlds, but I did have an idea that about a girl named Megan who lived in the city, who loved horses, but because she lived in the city, she really didn't get to see any. And that her coming over to Equestria through this portal and suddenly being surrounded by talking horses might be like an angle on the show or on a possible like special or something like that. If they had asked me to bring Megan or humans into the show, that was sort of a theme that I was playing with, but they didn't ask me to, so I didn't really pursue it.
Thank you very much for your question.
I'm sorry?
What's your thoughts on Equestria Girls?
I haven't seen a lot of Equestria Girls, I'm so sorry. It looks very cute.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, what's your question, Tom?
So I had a question about Fluttershy. What did we come up with her personality and design?
I mentioned earlier that I, you know, based the ponies off of characteristics that I gave to ponies that I played with when I was little, and I did have a little shy. I had two shy characters that I made up. One was Posey, and another one was named Seashell. And I don't know, something because I was a shy character, because I was a shy girl. Playing characters who were shy was important to me, and I thought that, you know, shy kids might like to see a representation of themselves in TV. So I made Fluttershy, I made her shy. She was originally based off of the G1 pony Posey. And then, you know, in trying to express what a shy, gentle character might look like, I gave her, you know, long, graceful hair to show her gentle side, but I also made it to be like a curtain that she hung over her face to hide. So that physicality of what her hair did expressed who she was inside. This was somebody who was gentle but was wanted to hide.
Okay, thank you.
Sure, thank you.
Speak directly into the mic, okay?
With the show in its now season, how would you describe how it's big as
a little close, it's really
maybe
hard.
We can raise the mic up. I think it might be a little low for most people.
With the show in its now season, how would you describe how big it's become after what you built?
How would you describe like the legacy of what you built?
Oh gosh, I wouldn't even know. What's happened with this show and the effect that it's had on people has been so astounding and surprising and nothing I ever could have dreamed of or anticipating. But, you know, I think that the part that makes me proud when you think about the legacy, what the meaning of the what maybe what this show means to the people that it affected is you know, friendship and kindness. And I think that that's what's resonated with people. I think that's why a lot of people are here today, you know, loving one another, taking care of one another, accepting each other for their differences. I hope that's what the legacy of this version of My Little Pony becomes.
Hello, thank you for coming to BronyCon. What I would like to ask you, before you described what you were planning to do with Scootaloo and Sweetie Belle, what about Apple? What was your original plan with her?
You know what, you know what's funny is that, like, when I originally came up with the, I didn't originally come up with the Crusaders, I originally came up with Apple Bloom exclusively. The little one who didn't have a cutie mark yet and wanted a cutie mark. So she didn't have this, when I came up with her alone, she didn't have this goal. Then Hasbro asked me, I said, hey, these two ponies, two G3 ponies, Scootaloo and Sweetie Belle are really popular, can you find a place for them? So I made the cutie mark Crusaders as a group. So Apple Bloom never quite had the trajectory that the other two had, just because she was created with a more simple idea in mind. The other two characters were an evolution of that idea. So I didn't have a really firm plan for her. I was hoping that as we made the show, it would become apparent. But where the Cutie Mark Crusaders landed in the show for real seems like that would have been a good place for Apple Bloom. That she, her purpose was to help others find their purpose. I thought that that was actually kind of a lovely idea for her.
Thank you. All right, this is a question that I've had on my mind for a few years now, and it's gonna sound a little non sequitur at first, but it does relate to Pony, because it's about like, okay, first of all, are you at all familiar with the Fire Emblem series?
With what?
The Fire Emblem video game series.
Fire Emblem video game. I'm afraid not.
Okay, because the character right here, I know you can't see it, but she is named Florina. She's a Pegasus Knight, and her description here reads, shy, gentle girl who loves animals.
Okay.
And I just wanted to hear from your mouth that, like, you, this is all a coincidence.
Your guess is as good as mine.
Would you consider Equestrian Girls part of your canon for the show?
Oh. That's not good.
First of all, thank you. I know you heard a million times, but you absolutely did change my life. So just thank you.
Thank you.
So you said many times in any of your interviews that when you started out, you were really trying to make a show that was different for girls. I was wondering why you thought men responded so heavily to My Little Pony, and if you think there's something missing in mainstream media that maybe they were getting from this.
Sorry, what was the last part of your question?
Was something missing from, like, media aimed at boys that they're getting out of, like, My Little Pony and things?
Oh, that's a good question. So I started out, I think, you know, I was frustrated growing up that I always say that things for girls were puddles of mushy, goody-two-shoe-ness. That's how I used to always kind of say it, that things were really soft, they were a little dumbed down, they were a little, like, too much about like sharing and caring and holding hands and skipping down the lane, and you know, and that's why people didn't like it, and that's why people thought that things for girls were dumb, and subsequently that's why they thought girls were dumb, and that's, you know, I grew up feeling the weight of that. So I wanted, when I made My Little Pony, I did want to change that. I wanted to make something that was compelling and fun and interesting and smart, and something that girls could be proud of liking, and that their brothers could, like, you know, they could argue with their brothers when they gave them a hard time about it. You know, coming from a show like Powerpuff Girls, I knew it was possible. I don't know how it resonated the way that it did. I mean, my theory had always been, actually, that a lot of the first people, the first guys who took a look at My Little Pony might have been taking a look at it to laugh at it. You know, they might have been watching it to kind of hate watch it and laugh it and tease it, and then were surprised that it wasn't what they expected, and that maybe the novelty of that was what kept them watching. That's my theory. I don't know. But when I ask people, you know, when I ask people early on, like, Why do you like it? I'm so surprised. I was very surprised to hear, you know, young men saying that they related to these characters, you know, these you know, pastel-colored ponies, that they were able to connect with their challenges and their feelings. That really surprised me, and made me proud that they were open enough to let themselves relate to these very, very girly characters. And perhaps that's what's missing. You know, maybe, you know, working in this business, when people are talking about we're targeting boys or we're targeting girls, when they talk about targeting boys, they just talk about jokes and fighting.
Still very stereotypical for boys.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. They talk, that's what they think boys want. And, they must be missing something, because they don't let their characters have feelings or emotions or flaws. And maybe we do need more of that for boys as well.
Well said! Well said!
We have time for one last question. This has to be the last one, I'm afraid. So unfortunately, we're at time, so this is the last one.
Lauren, did you spend some of your childhood?
I grew up here. I'm from Severna Park. I know the Inner Harbor like the back of my hand. I'm so sad I'm not going to get to go to the aquarium.
So what, were there any specific experiences in Maryland that somehow made it to your, to whether My Little Pony or any of the other things that you'd worked on?
Oh, I don't know if there's anything specific to Maryland, you know. It's just that I think, you know, this is where my creative brain was fashioned. This is where I bought all of my ponies at Kitty City in Glen Burnie. It's so if I had to connect anything that I've done to Maryland, it's just that this is where I grew, and this is where my creativity formed.
Thank you.
Thank you.